Thank you, Mary Sue. My name is Phil Bredesen, and I'm here because I was the governor of Tennessee from 2003 to 2011, spanning some of those times in which some of the many challenges to public universities came about. A couple of things. First of all, would like to say how much I believe in what the previous speakers have all just said, which is the importance of the research university community in general, the importance of the public research universities to the states and to the regions in which they operate. I live in Nashville, Tennessee, which is the home of Vanderbilt University, obviously a private research university, but have seen in so many ways the ways in which the presence of an organization like that enhances the quality of life, enhances the economic competitiveness in so many different ways of the community. And when it comes to the public versions of that, I think they're really important in a state's overall strategy. First of all, they provide a much broader access. They have more lower income students than a typical private university. They open up their access. And second of all, they can be melded a little more to the actual priorities and needs of a state individual. I mean, I'm standing here at Berkeley, and I suspect that there have been decisions made in Berkeley to make it as responsive as possible to the economic opportunities of what's going on in Silicon Valley, for example. And in a Tennessee where the equivalent university to, for us, the research university, is the University of Tennessee in Knoxville and in Memphis, they have an enormous impact on those regions of the state and on the state's ability to respond to different kinds of needs. Now, having said that, I think I'm on this commission because, unlike, I guess, most of the other members, I've actually cut the budgets of state universities in response to some of the problems that we've had, and so I think they asked me to come here and justify myself in some fashion. A couple things I would say to you as to what governors are looking at and the problems that they're trying to face today is, first of all, I would like you to recognize the enormous extent to which state budgets, particularly over the past 20 or 30 years, are moving out from under the control of state governors and of state legislatures, and are being driven by a number of federal programs. I give you an example: Medicaid, which in many states is the largest single expenditure in the state. It is in Tennessee. Medicaid didn't exist, obviously, in 1965. In 1980, we were spending as much on Medicaid as we were spending on public education in Tennessee. When I became governor, we were spending 2.5 times as much on Medicaid as we were spending on public education, K through 12 education. And that's a number which has just come in and continued to grow and takes a lot of the oxygen out of the room. When I was talking with the public and the legislature about just trying to give some perspective to this, I pointed out to them, for example, that in Tennessee, which is not, and this is not an unusual situation, you could find similar examples in other states, we spent more money on the pharmacy program in Medicaid than we spent on the higher education system. We spent more money on one drug in that program than we spent on the University of Tennessee Medical School. But the extent to which these programs, over which you have very little control, you simply pay the bills when they become due, are choking out other kinds of state investments, I hope you have to appreciate. It really is an enormous effect. Furthermore, the federal government has now come, as they did in 2008 and 2009, they will give you some money but insist on maintenance of effort in all these other things, and so further constrain your ability to move money around and to make decisions. For states, what it looks like is that there's many good things. Higher education is a very good thing. K through 12 education is a good thing. I started the big pre-K program. That is a good. That's a good thing. The various kinds of children's services we do are all good things. States have the constraints that they have to have balanced budgets. 49 of the 50 states have balanced budget legislation or constitutional provisions. 36 of them are constitutional. Some states, I'm standing in one, for example, have been generous in their interpretation of those requirements. but for most of us, we operate under a very different set of constraints than the federal government does, and really do have to find some way to bring these things to closure and to find ways of paying for these different things. I'd also like to say that I often thought that higher education did not do a very good job of making the case for themselves. And one of the things that I'm hoping to be able to bring to the discussion here of this group is to talk a little more about the kinds of arguments which I think will resonate with the broader public and the legislators who represent that broader public. A lot of the arguments out of the higher education community, it's an intrinsic argument, which is higher education is good, college degrees are good, everybody knows it's a good thing to do, why don't you fund this instead of something else? Okay. And yet, if you step back, I think you have to recognize that all of these things are being paid for. The money does not come out of the sky. They're being paid by people who work in factories and people who work as bricklayers and people who work as accountants who are sending some of their tax money to the state to buy these different kinds of services. And we owe them some kind of an accounting of that. We owe them, I think, and we need to be able to make a clear statement, not that higher education is good in its own right, but higher education is good in that it advances their values and things that they consider to be important for themselves and their families. And that's an argument which I think often is not made. Last thing I'd say is just as a practical matter in terms of the politics of this, kind of the view from a governor's chair of this that happens. When you become governor of any state, it's like when you become president, there is a long line of people whose mission it is to extract more money from you than you are presently giving them. Okay? I mean, it's just there's a very long line of people who simply want more money and believe quite honestly and quite sincerely that what they do is more important than that other stuff that goes on in the state, and you need to step up and fund these kinds of things. What you don't get so often, and which is really invited, is someone who brings to you some kind of a solution to the problem. And I'm hoping that as this commission continues to do its work, it can do more, and I think it will, than simply stand up and make an argument and publish a white paper as to why higher education is very, very, very important and you shouldn't forget that, and instead say, look, we're creative. We understand the problems that states are having and the federal government is having. Here's some ideas about how we can make the money go further. We can find other sources of these. Let me help you solve the problem instead of being one more petitioner for a larger and larger check. Thank you.